let's ask ourselves how questions in general are settled. What sort of questions can be settled? Well, there are two great classes of these questions about which this can be said with a certain firmness, I think. One is ordinary empirical questions. That's the questions about what there is in the world. This is the sort of thing which the sciences deal with. I mean, are there black swans in Australia? Yes, there are, because someone has seen them there. What is matter made of? It's made of certain types of molecules. Molecules are made of atoms. There is a certain amount of evidence for this because experiments are conducted, and these experiments are sometimes crucial and lead to the confirmation of theories. Common sense is like that. Where is the cheese? The cheese in the cupboard. How do you know? I've looked. This is regarded as a full and perfectly sufficient answer to this question, and I wouldn't doubt that, nor would you. These are called empirical questions, questions of fact which are settled either by ordinary common sense or in more complicated cases by rather controlled observation, by experiment, by hypotheses, by the verification of hypotheses, and so on. That's one type of question. Then there is a question, for example, there are formal questions, questions which mathematicians ask, which logicians ask. There you have a certain number of definitions, you have a certain number of transformation rules about how to deduce things from these definitions, and you have conclusions which follow in a rigorously logical manner from these premises. And there you have certain sets of rules in accordance with which all answers, all propositions can be checked. This is not about the world at all. This is about formal disciplines which are, so to speak, entirely divorced from questions of fact. Mathematics, logic, chess, heraldry. This, you don't discover the answer by looking at the window, by looking at the cupboard. If I ask you, how do you know that the king in chess moves any one square at a time? It's no good someone saying, well, you say he only moves one square at a time, but you know, one evening I was looking at a chessboard and I actually saw a king move two squares. This would not be regarded as a refutation of this proposition, because what you're really saying is there is a rule in chess, according to which the king, and how do you know the rule is true? The rules don't have to be true, they just have to be rules. You either accept them or you don't. This is how mathematics works in all formal disciplines. These are great provinces of human knowledge. Between these, if I may so put it, there are certain questions which cannot be answered in this fashion. And there are a great many such questions. The thing about the two classes I've just tried to explain about is that there are formal methods of how to set about the answer. You may not be able to know the answer to an empirical question, but you know what kind of answer the answer would be if you knew it. If you say, how long did Caesar live for? You may not know how many years he lived for, but you know how to find out. You know what kind of authors to look up. You know what kind of evidence would be evidence for it. If you ask, are there flightless birds in Thailand? Well, there may or may not be. You may not know the answer, but you would know what kind of experiments to conduct for the purpose of discovering it. The same is true of astronomy. We don't know what the other side of the planet Sirius looks like. You would never have seen it, perhaps. But you know that if you could fly there, as you can now fly to the moon, perhaps you would see it, it's all. This is true of formal disciplines equally. There are certain unsolved problems, but there are certain accepted methods for solving these. And you know that looking, smelling, touching won't do in mathematics. Calculation won't do in ordinary in the empirical sphere and so on. In the case of philosophy, the great hallmark, I would like to say, is that you don't know how to proceed. Someone says to you, what is the good? What are the ends of human life? Should we pursue pleasure or should we pursue justice or truth? Even if it doesn't give you any pleasure. How do you set about answering this question? Someone says to you, what do you mean by real? How do you distinguish reality from appearance? Somebody says to you, what is knowledge? What do we know? Can we know anything for certain? Apart from mathematical knowledge, is there anything else we know for certain? How do we know that we know it for certain? What do you do? We don't immediately. There isn't a formal discipline which we say, well, now, there's an expert. He'll be able to tell you what is good. He'll be able to tell you what is right. He'll be able to tell you what is duty. He'll be able to tell you what are rights. He'll be able to tell you whether happiness is the right goal for human beings or isn't. You just listen to him. The mathematician, of course, can answer mathematical questions. We don't think that there are moralists who give absolutely clear answers which any human being who can follow their reasoning is bound to accept. So therefore, there is a certain puzzle at the very beginning about where to look. Nobody quite knows what to do with them. There's a sort of sense of mental cramp which sets in fairly early in the case of ordinary men who ask themselves these questions until they stop asking them.
You've come to about something absolutely fundamental now, Sir Isaiah, and what I'd like to do, if I may, is, as it were, recapitulate what, how we've got to the point we're at before we start making further forward moves. Yes. I take it that what you're saying is that throughout the history of mankind, men in their search for knowledge have asked most commonly two kinds of questions. In the first place, there are questions about the world. Man is simply finding out about and mastering his environment and coping with his environment. And questions about the world are answered by looking at it, by investigation, observation, testing, experiment, and so on.
Yes.
These are factual questions. The second kind of question are questions of a more abstract or formal kind, like questions in mathematics or in logic or, as you said, in games or in heraldry. And with questions of this kind, you can't find out the answer by observing the world, because questions of this kind concern the interrelationships between entities inside formal systems, the one we most commonly use obviously being that of arithmetic or, more generally, mathematics. So you have empirical questions about the world, which involve looking at the facts, and formal questions which involve relating one thing to another inside a formal system. And that nearly all knowledge, nearly all questions, fall into one of these two baskets, so to speak. Now, what you're saying is, I take it, that philosophical questions, the hallmark of a philosophical question, is that it doesn't fall into either of these baskets. A question like, what is a right, is something that you can neither find the answer to by looking out of the window, nor find the answer to by looking at the internal coherence of a formal system. And therefore, you don't know how to go about finding the answer. And this this possession of a question without any understanding of how to look for the answer is, as it were, the hallmark of a philosophical question. Is that...
You put it right? Far better than I have, yes, much more clearly.
Well, you put it first.
Yes, but I accept this reformulation of it with pleasure.
Yeah.